Now the angel continues, verse 12. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Now this is the third time already in the Gospel of Luke we've seen an angelic message, haven't we? And in each of the three, there is always with the message a sign pointed to, so that the one hearing the message could check it out and could know that the message is truly from God. Now the Bible warns us that if an angel seemingly from heaven comes and shares a different gospel with you, for example, don't listen to him. The devil himself is an angel, isn't he? And he doesn't show up with ominous music and the pitchfork and the long tail. He shows up as an angel of light, doesn't he? So, first was Zacharias. Hey, your wife is going to give you a son. John the Baptist is going to be born. The sign was what? Zacharias, who didn't believe, was struck mute. Not a very pleasant sign, but a sign nonetheless. What about Mary, though? You say, now, wait a minute. Mary was promised that the virgin birth and all, but I don't remember a sign associated with Mary, but there was one. You remember the angel said, it's now the sixth month that your relative Elizabeth is with child, the one who everyone said was barren and could never give birth. And so what did Mary do, of course? As soon as the angel leaves, she packs up and she goes and visits Elizabeth, and she sees 6 months, she's showing pretty good. Yep, angel's true. And here as well. Guys, go check it out. How often do you see a baby lying in a feeding trough, wrapped in the strips of cloth like that? So go check it out. The specific details are all going to be coming to pass. Now, one thing I want to make mention of, because I know that many of you, of course, probably follow along in the New King James, because that's what I teach from each week, and it's a little bit easier for you to follow. But if you have a different translation, depending on what the translation is, you might notice verse 14 reads differently. Now, in the Old King James or the New King James, it reads as I just read it, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. This is what Linus said in the Snoopy cartoon that we're all familiar with. This is so well known, and I only say that half jokingly, because we all have seen that, and it's just in our head, that when you come across this passage in your NIV or your New American Standard or some other translation, it reads kind of differently, and you wonder what's going on here. Because in those translations, you read something along the lines of glory to God in the highest, or in the highest heaven, that's fine. And then, and on earth, peace towards men of goodwill, or towards men on whom God's favor rests, or something along those lines. And you say, well, that's kind of different. I don't get it. Now, here I have just spent several minutes at the beginning of the message telling us how we can have confidence that the Bible is the Word of God, how we can trust our Bible, that it's from God, and now I come across a verse where I say, well, there's a couple ways of looking at this, and that's why it's translated differently. And the reason it's translated differently is because there's a couple families of manuscripts that are slightly different. So what gives? Can I trust my Bible or not? Well, let me ask you this. Is there any debate that Jesus was born in Bethlehem? That these angels appeared to shepherds at night? That they gave a message to those shepherds, a very good message? They told them where to go? That the message involved glory to God and peace on earth? Is there any debate about any of that? No. So we're talking about what is in effect one-third of one verse. So for argument's sake, go ahead and throw out that one-third of one verse and now deal with what the text says. Do you believe it or not? See? So someone who wants to reject the biblical revelation because of the occasional one-third of one verse situations that do come along, well, that's not intellectual honesty. See, the Bible, like any ancient book, and actually the Bible is, of course, multiple books and letters that are put together in one Bible, but we've got letters from Paul and Peter, and we've got the four Gospels and the book of Acts. But it was written before there was a printing press. It was written by hand. Like any ancient book of literature, we don't have the original writings. They couldn't last that long. We have copies. We have copies of copies of copies. That's true with every ancient book. Copies that are made by hand, with poor lighting for the most part. And if you happen to wear glasses or contacts, take those off, because those wouldn't have been available to you at the time. And so you can see how on occasion, no matter how carefully the copyist tried to be, a mistake could be made. And then, of course, when that copy is copied again, it continues on, does it not? But here's the thing about the Bible. And here's the fruit of the years of labors of truly brilliant men and women of the past. The person who criticizes the Bible for the occasional one-third of one verses, where there's either A or B for a choice, I said they're not being intellectually honest, because, you know, those same people, they'll quote you with authority, Plato, or they'll talk to you about, oh, you know, when Caesar wrote the Gallic Wars, or when Pliny wrote the Roman history, and Josephus, he wrote that. Well, we don't have their original writings. We just have copies of their copies. And there's, by the way, debate about what those guys wrote as well. But here's the thing. The evidence we have for any of those other ancient writers is absolutely minuscule compared to what we have for the Bible. Because not only do we have thousands of Greek manuscripts, the New Testament being written in Greek originally, but right from the very beginning, it was being translated into other language. Latin, Coptic, you name it. And so we have translations. We also have, from the very beginning, early Christians, well, who we call the church fathers of those early centuries, writing letters to each other where they're quoting scripture, just like we might quote scripture to each other in an email. In fact, the early church fathers are writing commentaries on entire books of the Bible, just like people write commentaries today. We have the lectionaries, the worship manuals of early churches, the services where they would actually sing scripture, just like we do today in many cases. We've got all this evidence. And it all gets evaluated, it all gets looked at in an effort to find out, now, what was that verse? And when all is said and done, as you know, over 99% of the scripture, we just absolutely don't have the slightest doubt that what we're reading is exactly what God's Word said. And so you get one third of one verse here where it said, well, maybe it said goodwill toward men, or maybe it said peace towards men of goodwill. Does that really affect the Christian faith? Hardly. No, you can trust your Bibles. You can count on it as God's Word.